So today let's take a look at another switching power supply module, which was donated to me. So thank you for your donation, and it probably comes from eBay, and it's the kind of switching power supplies which are probably recycled from scrap electronics and resold basically. But it comes in a nice static protective bag, and here's the power supply, and I can see some cut wires here from the mains input and the output here. So it's a recycled power supply. But anyway, it looks nice. I'm not sure what's the rating. It's probably 5 volts, 2 amps. Does it say something here? Not. And it has a very nice isolation distance on the board. The mains comes in here, and there is a nice fuse in some heat shrink, and a metal oxide varistor for overvoltage protection. It looks like 470 volts. Some interference capacitor. This is probably the inrush resistor. Some interference inductor, a common mode filter with two windings on it. The main smoothing capacitor here. The bridge rectifier is made of discrete diodes here. And across one of the windings of this common mode interference inductor, there is some kind of, it looks like diode, but it's probably some tiny spark gap or zener or some other overvoltage protection. That's weird. And here's the main switching transistor on a tiny heatsink. Basically the heatsink is roughly the same size as the transistor, so it doesn't probably have much benefits, but here's some auxiliary capacitor, some snubber network capacitor probably, or interference capacitor. Here's the interference capacitor between the primary and the secondary side, and it looks like a safety capacitor. Here's the main switching transformer, an optocoupler. This is probably the voltage reference, probably 431. And here's the secondary diode, probably Schottky and two capacitors. Each of them is different. And here's the output, which is cut. But it's in some kind of resin or hot melt glue, so it's a bit annoying. And there is some other diode here. Is it rectifying the auxiliary power, or is it the part of this snubber network? And now let's take a look from the other side of it. The interference capacitor has discharging resistors here, two in series to increase the voltage rating, because those tiny SMD resistors don't have much voltage rating. And the same for the main smoothing capacitor. Again, two SMD resistors in series as a discharging resistor. And here's the control chip, a tiny SMD 6-pin chip, and a couple more SMD capacitors and resistors. And the pins of the transistor and the transformer. And on the secondary side, the pins of the secondary electrolytic capacitors plus some discharging resistor for them. And here is the diode, and it looks like it has space in it for a diode in a TO220 package, but they put just this diode on it. Of course, a diode in a TO220 package is better because it can go on a heatsink. This one has no heatsink, so it's probably going to get bloody hot. And there is some resistor network and some capacitor for this voltage reference. It basically drives this optocoupler. And the secondary of the transformer seems to have no pins. The secondary winding goes into those wires instead of into pins. And now the problem is that I was donated multiple different power supply modules, and I put it all into one box and mixed it, and now I don't know what's the rating of those. One of them has to be 5 volts, 2 amps, but it's probably going to be this one because it has 10 volt capacitors at the output. And this one has capacitors rated for a higher voltage. One is 16 volts, 1000 micro, and the other one is 25 volts, 470 micro. So I guess this one is 12 volts. And here's the output, and let's start removing the resin from it, or this annoying glue, and it reveals that there is some space for some inductor and some extra capacitor here, but it's omitted. So the high frequency ripple at the output is going to be higher now. And this secondary diode is a bit cheapened out because it's a type which doesn't go on a heatsink, but it seems to have a snubber network on it with this capacitor and this resistor here. And luckily the resin is kind of removable. But now let's try to power it. I think it's 12 volts and probably 1 amp, maybe 2 amps, but it looks more like 1 amp. So now let's give it some random dodgy Soviet cable and let's test it. And let's plug it in. Does it blow up? It doesn't. And let's measure the voltage at the output. 11.5 volts. It was probably supposed to be 12 volts, wasn't it? So I gave it two pairs of cables. One is for the multimeter to measure the voltage and the other one is to load it and measure the current. And this way the voltage measurement is not affected by the voltage drop of the cables. So let's plug it in and try to load it. Here is the voltage with no load. Now let's try to load it at about half an amp. And the voltage doesn't change. At half an amp, let's try about 1 amp. And the voltage still doesn't change. Let's try about 2 amps. 2.5 almost, and still the same voltage at 2.5 amps. It seems to have a nice current capability, but of course I don't know if it can supply this current continuously. Now let's try 3 amps, and it shuts down. So about 2.5 amps is the maximum. So I guess it's a 2 amp design. So let's try to run it at 1.85 amps for a while. And 1 hour later, it still runs with no explosion. But it's probably quite hot. This capacitor is fine. Fine, interference filter fine, transistor. The transistor is... it's too hot to touch, but not too hot for a transistor. The transformer is... kind of fine. The capacitors... they are quite cool, given that the diode is quite close. And this capacitor is also cold. So it shouldn't wear out super fast. But this diode is quite hot. Let's try to touch it using wet tissue. It's not hissing, so it's less than 100 degrees Celsius. I have seen a lot of power supplies where the secondary diode was hissing, so this one is definitely not the worst one. It really doesn't look so bad. Nothing is hissing and those capacitors are not thermally coupled to the diode too much, which is good. And of course here is it on my oscilloscope and the upper trace is the secondary winding. And you can see that here the transistor is on the primary side. Here it's off and the secondary diode is conducting and here the transformer is ringing. Nothing is conducting here, and then it repeats. The transistor turns on, then it turns off, the diode is conducting, and ringing because the energy ran out in the core of the transformer. And of course it's a flyback switching power supply, so when the transistor is on, the diode on the secondary side is in reverse. And when the transistor turns off, the polarity of the voltage on the transformer swaps and the diode is conducting, transferring the energy to the secondary side, to the capacitor. And there is some time when the transformer is ringing, so it means that it runs in a discontinuous conduction mode. The transistor basically turns on after the energy runs out in the core of the transformer. And it's a fried core with an air gap. And the other trace is the voltage ripple at the output. And this voltage ripple seems to come from the internal resistance of the secondary capacitor. As the energy runs out in the transformer, the current through the diode goes down, and also this voltage goes down, proportionally to it. So it seems like this is the voltage drop of the internal resistance of the capacitor on the secondary side. Or its equivalent series resistance, basically. And also there are some very short spikes here. Some voltage overshoot is basically when the transistor turns off, because then the diode starts conducting a current, and because of the internal inductance of the capacitor, the voltage very shortly overshoots. Let's zoom it a little bit. So this is the voltage ripple at the output. This slope is because of the equivalent series resistance of the capacitors. The voltage is basically proportional to the current through the diode. And those overshoots are because of the equivalent series inductance of the capacitors. Now it's 50 mV per division. And it's about 5 divisions, so it's about 250 mV peak-to-peak ripple. And of course those traces are getting progressively out of focus from left to right. And this is because the chip periodically changes its operating frequency, probably to reduce the interference. It kind of wobbles the frequency. Now the time base is 5 microseconds per division and the period of the signal is about 3 divisions, so it's about 15 microseconds. And so the frequency should be 1 divided by 0.000015 seconds or 15 microseconds, and this is 66,000 Hz or 66 kHz. And the secondary voltage is 20 volts per division. So it seems to be about 60 volts peak to peak. And of course, as in most mains flybacks, the forward peak voltage is much higher than the flyback peak voltage. About 4 times. The flyback voltage is basically the voltage at the output, about 12 volts. So the forward voltage has to be about 48 volts. And the secondary diode has to be rated for the peak-to-peak voltage, about 60 volts, at least. But to have some headroom, it has to be at least 80 or even better 100 volts. But there are some Schottky diodes rated for 100 volts. And I guess the diode is probably Schottky. And that's why it's not getting so hot, because a Schottky diode has a lower voltage drop. As you can see, this is more or less a normal flyback switching power supply, running in a discontinuous conduction mode. And at the output, the biggest spike is when the transistor turns off, but there is also a little spike when it turns on. And this one is probably because of the current through the stray capacitances. It shouldn't be the reverse recovery current of the diode because it's a discontinuous conduction mode. The diode stops passing a current before the transistor turns on. And this is fully loaded. When it's loaded less, the duty cycle goes down. This is loaded at 0.6 amps and 1.8 amps. 0.6 amps. And now without any load, it significantly reduces the frequency, it seems. And the frequency wobbles. With no load, the frequency seems to be about 25 kHz. Very short duty cycle and a lot of ringing. And now let's try to draw the schematic of it. So I had to remove some of the components to see the markings or to be able to measure them. And here's the schematic of it. With no cat on it, and let's take a look at it. It's more or less a normal flyback switching power supply with a MOSFET and a control chip, but there are some oddities. It has two fuses and each of them has a different current rating, and one is in live, one in neutral. The first one is 5 amps and it's before the metal oxide varistor, and the other one is just 2 amps and it's after the metal oxide varistor. This big yellow one. Here it is. So it seems like there is a higher current rated fuse before the metal oxide varistor, so it's less likely to blow during some short high voltage transient or overshoot coming from the mains. And after this there is a lower current rated fuse, probably for fire safety. And there is a safety class X2 capacitor for interference suppression and some interference inductor, a common mode filter with two windings, 120 turns each, and discharging resistors for this capacitor. And this common mode interference inductor has a strange component across it. It's marked metal oxide varistor or MOV on the board, but it's in a small glass package here. It looks like a small glass diode, but it's marked MOV. It probably limits the inductive spikes from this inductor, and then there is a bridge rectifier made of discrete diodes. The main primary smoothing capacitor, an electrolytic one, this one, and also a tiny ceramic capacitor in parallel to it to reduce probably its internal resistance and inductance. And here's the switching transformer with a ferrite core, probably with an air gap, and the primary, the secondary, and the auxiliary winding. And the primary winding has a snubber network on it, and there is also this interference capacitor between the primary and the secondary side, which reduces the common mode interference at the output. And basically the high frequency capacitive current that goes from the primary to the secondary goes back through this capacitor, so it doesn't go to the output. Because of course the transformer has a stray capacitance between the windings, and the primary has quite a high voltage on it, high frequency voltage, so the capacitive current basically has to have a return path. So there is not such a high common mode, high frequency voltage at the output. And it's a safety class Y1 capacitor, so it should be safe to put it between the primary and the secondary side. And here's the switching transistor, which is controlled by this chip. The transistor is basically switching the primary, and the chip controls its gate. And there is a current sensing resistor, and the voltage on it is sensed via this resistor, and it goes into the chip, and some very short overshoots are filtered by this capacitor. And this resistor probably sets the frequency, the switching frequency. And of course another oddity is that this capacitor goes from the positive, not from the negative, as usual. And another oddity is this zener diode. I was originally thinking that it regulates the auxiliary power for the chip, but it doesn't. It goes from the positive of the auxiliary capacitor, but not to the negative here. It goes to this current sensing pin. So if there was an overvoltage in this auxiliary power, the zener would pass a current into this pin and it would probably shut down or limit the duty cycle. When this zener passes a current, it basically raises the voltage on this pin, so it's acting similar as if there is an overcurrent in this transistor. And I still have to try to identify the chip, but it seems like this pin is the current sensing, this is the positive of the auxiliary power for it, this is the gate output, this is the negative of it. This pin seems to be the feedback. It goes to the optocoupler, and via this optocoupler the voltage is sensed at the output. And this pin is probably the frequency setting. And it's a switching power supply, so it's basically switching at a high frequency, about 60 or 70 kHz in this case. And there is a square wave at the output for the gate, and the transistor is switching the primary, and the chip basically controls the duty cycle. Initially the duty cycle is higher, and then when the output reaches basically the desired voltage, the voltage of this resistive divider is 2.5 volts. Because this type of voltage reference starts passing a current like this at 2.5 volts at its input. And then it's basically powering this infrared LED inside of the optocoupler, and it illuminates this phototransistor in it and pulls this feedback pin down, and the chip starts limiting the duty cycle. And so the voltage no longer goes up on those capacitors. After the startup, the voltage basically goes up on them until it reaches 12 volts, and then it reduces the duty cycle, so the voltage doesn't go up anymore, it just keeps it at 12 volts. If the output voltage was too high, the duty cycle would go down, and if it was too low, the duty cycle would go up to keep it at 12 volts. And via this capacitor there is a negative feedback from the output to the input of the reference for stability, so it doesn't change too fast basically. The feedback has to be slowed down, otherwise it would overcompensate, undercompensate, overcompensate, undercompensate. The feedback would basically oscillate. And of course this LED in the optocoupler has a parallel resistor, because this voltage reference, even when it's off, still passes a little bit of a current, because it actually needs some current for its operation. And this resistor basically bypasses this LED for low currents. So this LED only lights up at a higher current. And the secondary diode is a Schottky, 100 volts, 5 amps, and it even has a snubber network on it, which is nice. And I measured about 81 volts on this snubber capacitor, 15 volts on this capacitor, and 2.25 volts on the transistor of this optocoupler. And this transistor is rated 600 volts. The voltage of European mains is 230 volts, and when you rectify it, the DC voltage after the rectification is the voltage times the square root of 2, so you get about 325 volts here, and this voltage of the snubber capacitor actually adds to this voltage, so you get about 406 volts here at the transistor. But of course there has to be more headroom because it's probably for universal mains, which is from 100 volts in some countries up to 240 volts AC, and it still has some error, usually plus minus 10%, so there can be about 264 volts at the output, and basically this plus the 10% error in the worst case. So the mains can be potentially up to 264 volts and times the square root of 2, which is 1.414, 373 volts in the worst case. So there is potentially up to 373 volts here, in reference to here, of course. And it was loaded 0.6 amps during the test, but when it's more loaded, the overshoots are probably a bit bigger here, and this voltage on this capacitor can be even higher. And of course this voltage is the average voltage on this capacitor, but it's a low capacitance, so it actually ripples here, and the peak level is even higher. So some flyback switching power supplies have a 500 volt transistor, but there is not much headroom then, so it's better to use a 600 volt transistor for a flyback switching power supply for a universal mains. Because of course in a flyback, the flyback voltage of the primary is adding to the rectified mains voltage. And there is another oddity, and that's the startup resistor. It normally goes from this auxiliary capacitor to the positive of the main smoothing capacitor. But here, it goes to the neutral, or one of the AC inputs, basically. And the reason for that is probably to reduce the average dissipation of those resistors, because basically if you drop the voltage from this, you have about 325 volts here, but if you drop it from the AC voltage, you have only 230 volts in average. So the average dissipation of the resistor is lower when you drop it from the AC voltage. Instead of dropping the voltage from the peak level, it's averaging the voltage across a half cycle, basically, so the average voltage drop on those resistors is lower, and also the dissipation is lower for the given current. And it has one more implication. When you unplug it, it wouldn't try to restart using the remaining charge on this capacitor. Not sure if it's good or bad, but there is no discharging resistor for this capacitor. There are only discharging resistors for this interference capacitor. And of course those dropping resistors are just for the startup, and then the chip is powered from this auxiliary winding via this resistor and this diode. And this capacitor filters the auxiliary power, of course. And basically powering these dropping resistors from the AC voltage reduces their dissipation to about 70%, or square root of 2 times lower. But even then, the dissipation of the resistors would be too high if the chip was powered just via those resistors. So it uses the resistors to start up, and then it's powered from this auxiliary winding. And this winding is probably rectified in the flyback direction. So it's like this. The current through those resistors is not enough to continuously run the chip. And this has another effect. If there is no power coming from this auxiliary winding, the chip will not run continuously. The capacitor will basically charge via those resistors until it reaches the higher or upper undervoltage threshold, and it will start running, but because those resistors supply lower current than the chip consumes, the capacitor discharges until it reaches the lower undervoltage threshold, and then the chip stops running, and then it repeats. When it stops running, it doesn't draw much current and the capacitor recharges and it's all repeating basically, and this is the notorious cycling of faulty power supplies. Faulty switching power supplies are usually cycling or clicking or pulsing when they are faulty or overloaded or shorted out. If, for example, the output is overloaded or this diode is shorted out or there is some other short circuit at the output, it basically overloads this winding, but also, because of the coupling of those windings, the voltage on this winding also goes down and it can't supply enough voltage for the chip, and so the chip relies only on the current from those resistors and it's not running continuously, it's pulsing. It basically tries to restart in cycles. And this is actually good because if something is overloaded or shorted out at the secondary side, it doesn't overheat by continuously trying to bring the voltage up at the output. So it contributes to the short circuit proofness at the output. But of course now I can't do the short circuit test because I already removed a lot of components to be able to reverse engineer it. And both the secondary winding and the auxiliary winding are rectified in the flyback direction, so the voltage on those capacitors should correlate with the voltage on this capacitor, or vice versa. And this has another important function. If, for example, the output voltage is too high, then the voltage on this capacitor probably would be also too high, and then this overvoltage protection will kick in. If the voltage is too high here, it will also be too high here, and this zener will pass a current into this pin and it will shut down or limit the duty cycle. And this is especially important if there is some fault in the feedback, because if the feedback breaks, the voltage will go up almost infinitely at the output, or actually it will go up until something blows probably, and so this overvoltage protection is quite important and useful to protect the load. But of course, if you tried to modify the output voltage, this protection would also kick in. So it's not possible to increase the voltage at the output much. And if you modified it the other way, if you reduce the output voltage basically, the voltage goes down also here, on this auxiliary winding, so this voltage may then not be enough to run the chip. So if you try to modify it to a lower output voltage, probably by modifying this resistive divider, it may not run properly because with a lower voltage here, it will also have a lower voltage here and it may be cycling. So if you modify the output voltage of a flyback switching power supply, keep in mind that the voltage that goes into the chip changes proportionally, and also the voltage on this snubber capacitor changes proportionally. So if you increase the voltage at the output too much, the overvoltage protection may kick in, or it may damage the chip, or also you may get too high voltage on the transistor and damage the transistor. All the voltages basically change proportionally. And of course it's also possible to modify the overcurrent protection by changing this resistor. A higher resistance means a lower current threshold. But of course increasing the maximum current is not recommended. It's actually possible to turn it into a variable power supply in a certain range. You could probably put a potentiometer here and reduce the resistance of this resistor, and then you have to rely just on the power through those resistors for the chip, because this voltage will also vary with the output voltage. So then you have to disconnect it here and probably put a zener here to regulate the voltage for the chip and reduce significantly the resistance of those resistors, so the chip is powered just via those resistors, but of course they have to be rated for a high power dissipation then. It's possible to completely get rid of the auxiliary winding here and run it via those resistors, but of course with a lot of dissipation in them. And this zener is probably also not necessary then. But of course the safety of this power supply looks quite nice. There is quite a big isolation distance between the primary and the secondary side, and there is a safety capacitor between the primary and the secondary side, a class Y1 capacitor, and so it should be safe. And the only question now is this transformer safe? So of course I have to make an autopsy of it. And it looks like quite a nice power supply. It has an interference filter, an inductor, capacitor, it has two fuses, which is quite unusual, it has overvoltage protection, snubber networks, this safety capacitor for interference suppression, a nice voltage sensing, some overvoltage protection at the input, some metal oxide varistors, and whatever is this. Even this ceramic capacitor here in parallel to this one, which is unusual. The only disadvantage is that this output inductor and another capacitor are omitted, which leads to a higher voltage ripple at the output. Basically a differential mode interference at the output. But now of course the autopsy of the transformer. Desoldering it, and I cracked it a bit now, of course, and the secondary goes via wires, not pins, which may actually make it safer. It probably reduces the risk of the primary and auxiliary windings touching the secondary terminals. So there is a lot of this notorious yellow sticky tape on it. And another from here. So let's start unwrapping it. There is also some marking on it. And it seems to be nicely isolated so far. Another sticky tape here over the core, and some unusual shape of a ferrite core. Let's heat it to disassemble the core. And it comes apart. It's an interesting shape of a core. And another isolation here on top of the windings. And the first winding comes out. And it's probably the auxiliary. And it seems nice. It seems to keep some distance from the edges so it doesn't fall into the gap and touch the other windings. So it seems to be the auxiliary with 1, 2, 8, 9 turns, and then some isolation on it. And the primary. And the primary is 1, 2, 3, 13, 14. And then it goes into this center tap, which is not connected anywhere. It seems to be a split primary. One half of the primary is under the secondary and one is over it, for better coupling. And then there is some isolation, one layer, two layers, and some safety secondary, with a thick isolation on it. Not a normal lacquer, but some thicker isolation for safety. But of course, let's count it. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 turns on the secondary. And the isolation seems to go nicely all the way to the edges, and one layer, probably just one layer, but it should be fine given that there is this safety wire for the secondary with a thick insulation, not a normal lacquer. And the other half of the primary, which can actually be a bigger half, is 1, 2, 35, 36. So that's the transformer, and the directions of the windings seem to correlate with those dots. And the primary is 14 plus 36 turns, 50 in total. So it seems to be a safe transformer and a safe power supply. I like it. And of course my cat likes it too. And of course I forgot to measure this zener. It drops about 20 volts at 1 milliamp and 21.5 volts at 20 milliamps. And of course the air gap in the center column of the core of the transformer. A ferrite core. And so this is Diagnowild, and see you in my next videos, and thanks to all of my patrons on Patreon. I really appreciate your support. And I also plan to take a look at this interesting flashlight, which has a built-in insect zapper. Probably some ultraviolet LEDs and some high voltage inverter and some grid.